In this video, we're going to look at the user interface of Switcher Studio on your iPad or iPhone. So you've got different elements on different aspects of the screen. So you'll see at the top of the screen, you've got different windows, and each of the different windows cycles through a different scene. So at the moment, you've got the main camera here, which is the device camera, but I'm going to remove that for now. So at the top of the screen, you've got different elements. You've got the overlays, which are already here and ready for you to edit. You've also got the lower thirds, which you can see here is the demo. So you've got Juan Manuel Gomez. You've got the overlay, which is the main overlay, which you can see here. And then lastly, you've got an overlay that you can see in terms of multi-view. So if you wanted to select more than one camera angle, you can do that quite nicely there as well. At the bottom of the screen where the blue plus is, you'll see that when you tap that, you will have lots of options on the screen. You've got an option for photo, you've got an option for video, options for text, graphics, logo, inputs, switches, cloud, multi-views, and audio. Photo will allow you to import photos from your photo roll. So if you have a look in there at the moment, you can have a look at your photo library. Obviously, if you don't have anything in there at the moment, allow access to all photos and you'll see everything in there that you need. Okay. Imported images shows you imported images that you've used before. So I've got a couple of examples here based on some music projects that I've done. You could also bring in files from USB. If you had a little dongle that attached to your device with a lightning adapter, you can do that quite nicely. Switcher Cloud is a feature that comes with your account that allows you to store assets in the cloud. So you can see here are some things I did for a quiz, and so you could then bring in all of these. And then samples are examples that you can use in your productions. So going then to video, you've got a load of different ways you can bring in video. Much like with photo, you can go into your photo library, you can import your videos, things like that. You can again do into files from USB, Switcher Cloud, or samples. So in my photo library, I've just got some examples of video that we can tap in, and all we do to bring one in is we just tap on that source. So I've just got a really mundane image of a keyboard at the moment, and this is basically all the options down here. It asks you to frame it in different ways, whether you want it to be able to be full centered or you want it to be partially in the middle of the screen. You've got edge spreading, so if it's a small picture or video that doesn't quite reach the full screen, you can stretch it out. You can change the highlight color quite simply by clicking on the swatch of the outer color. And then scrolling down, you can then change the position. You can zoom in, so if you wanted to make a thumbnail, or you can zoom out as well. So if you wanted to try and change that position, you can do that too. If it's a video that has audio, you can enable the audio, or you just toggle off just to have a quiet, silent video as well. You can trim the video, and you can also change the audio of the video as well. So when you're happy with that, just click done, and it will then appear as a bit of footage that you can then use in your production. So you can see when you click on it, you can see that the video plays, and then you can use that as part of your b-roll. Going back into the blue circle then with the plus, text and graphics, you can then create a whole range of text and graphics. You can go into titles and create your own title of different designs. You could also have a preview video that shows you basically bustling around before the actual event starts. You can have overlay text, and you can have full screen text as well. Have a little go of doing one of these and you'll have lots of fun with these. So we can, for example, click your text here, and then we can then edit this. We could just put maybe test. You can change the size of this text. Okay, so if you don't want it to be too big, you can also change the alignment if you want it centered or right. At the moment, we're just having it centered. You can change the font by clicking on font and scrolling through every single font you could possibly imagine. And you can also change the style. So if you don't want it to be bold, or change it to bold italic, you can do. For this particular font, it won't allow you to do that. Change the case, again, the color, the box color. So if you didn't want it to be white, you could change the color to say something that would match your brand. And then you could change it to blue. Text transparency, if you didn't want it to be too much. Background transparency, if you wanted it to be just slightly blue. So your test text, you can drag and drop it around the screen as well. You can dim and change the line spacing. So if you had other text underneath, you could do that quite easily. You can change the corner radius. So if you wanted it more rounded rather than square, you could do that. Horizontal padding is basically where you stretch out the outer perimeter of the shape. Vertical padding the same, but you can have it stretched out like that. And the orientation as well. Just by using this little dial, you can change the orientation of the text. Apply on preview means if you have a preview, then when you tap it, normally then kind of syncing that up ready to go, it will then allow you to have that straight away shown on that preview. So if you, rather than you getting scenes ready and then clicking go, it will then automatically add them into your scene as well. And when it says stay on top, anything else that you put on your image, this will stay on top. So this is handy for things like overlays and things you want to be able to keep on the top of your image. When you're done, tap done and it will then appear as a source that you can then use in your production. And of course, tap your video again and then you can play that when you want to. So there you've got a basic overlay, and then you've also got some text as well that you can then bring in. That is just simply amazing. You could go amazingly crazy on that. Logos, same idea. Corner bugs, a little logo if you want in the corner of your production, you can do that too. So if you click on the photo library, I've got a logo here as an example. You can then use that, drag it around, and then same with the other options. You can change the verticality, the horizontal nature of it. Apply on preview, stay on top, which is quite useful if you've got a logo. That means every single scene change that you change to, that logo will stay there and it will not move. So next we have got the inputs. Now this is where you can change and select your inputs as well. Now at the moment I'm using my phone for this video, but I'm also using my iPad to be able to control the recording of this video. So I've actually got my iPad here. This is what I'm using to screen share from my iPad as a source in my other iPad as the director source as well, which is really, really useful. So you can then set up different ways of changing the scenes and interact between them as well. So the next element we've got then is Switcher Cloud. And Switcher Cloud, as I've already explained, allows you to store assets in the cloud on your account, and then you can then transfer those. This is really useful for transferring assets between devices. So if you've got an iPad that you eventually get rid of or you sell it, you can then have all those assets in the cloud and then ready to download to your new iPad. You can also share the assets, which I'll show you in a different video as well. So going back then to multi-view, then you can have a number of different views. You can have 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6 or more. You can have up to 9 different views for Switcher Studio then. So if you go into two views, okay, at the moment we've only got one camera. So what I'll do is we'll go into two views and we'll just set up very simply. Same idea, you can change the number of sources. So if you actually find you've got more than two, you can just tap them in and edit this anytime. The duration of the change between each one, I always set to about 0.5 seconds. So it kind of gives a nice clear quick change between them. Change the background color, change the images that you can see with it, the background image opacity, horizontal gap, reflection, perspective and reflection gap. These are just graphic qualities that you can see here that I'm sliding with the slider. Perspective obviously changes the perspective of the sources, and the reflection gap, obviously how much distance do you want between the main image and its reflection down below. You could of course restore default settings and it'll bring you back, but I'm just going to stick as they are here. And as you can see then, it brings it up on the screen. When you tap on this, it then says multi-view, select channels A and B. So let's say that angle A is going to be my, let's just say we're going to include this built-in camera. So here we're going to have a multi-view. So basically we're just going to have a really sort of mundane image. And what then happens, we can then select the video. We're going to have two different views side by side. We can also go into our multi-view and choose a different one. Say we wanted to do some sort of demo video, we could have a full screen and a small screen. We can change the size of that smaller screen. So if you wanted it to be your face, you can change the shape, the color, all the positionings of that on here. Lots and lots of options, very similar to what we've shown you before. Click done, and then you've basically got another view that you can have. So you can have, for example, you could have the main view of the keyboard and then tap on the over of the multi-view, and then you can go main keyboard and then the little extra image as well. So even with just one device, you can actually direct your very own video production just with one device, and it's super, super useful. So if we next go back into audio, this is a relatively new feature from Switcher Studio, but you can actually include different audio samples and also sources as well. So you can include audio from video. Again, same idea, you can either have them from your photo library or the cloud or imported videos. But also you've got these new ones as well, which are samples. You can actually have bells and you can then play, and you can hear that when I play, it plays that sound as well. So you think, well, I quite like that. All I do, if I want to have a scene, let's say I go into my, say I'm filming my face or something, then I just go, right, let's go give me a trigger sign. Now you'll know that you won't be able to hear it when you're using your Switcher Studio, but it will be output to your recording. So even though you cannot monitor it that way, you can output it to your recording as well. So you can edit any of these assets that you've got. You can reorder them, duplicate or remove them. So I'm going to edit this one and I'm going to change the volume down just a shade. And if I wanted to change the tag or the name of the sound, I could do. I can also click done and it's done. If I wanted to remove it, you just hold your finger down and then tap remove and it removes it just like that. So over on the right hand side then, we're going to have a look at the UI and show you all the different elements of that. So over on the right hand side then, we have got different sources and different outputs. So scrolling across the bottom, starting from the left hand side, I've got different camera control options. Now your order may be different and I'm going to show you how you can change the order of these in just a moment. So you can see here we've got the camera controls and from each source you'll be able to change and sort out the zoom, exposure, white balance, LED lighting, stabilization and lock autofocus when live. This will only apply to the current device. I'm going to show you later on something called director mode, which will be super useful in terms of controlling other devices as well. These options are available to you. You can see the inputs as listed at the moment. It does detect that my phone and my iPad are available on the network, but because I'm using my phone and my iPad to record this current tutorial video, it will not allow me to use them. If I tap on them, it will completely and utterly just go round and round and round. It will not be able to have them on board. But you'll be able to select your inputs and you'll be able to tap them on and off and they will come on and off whenever you wish to. So it's really handy if you don't want to use a particular source anymore, but it will stay ready to go. So if you think, well, I want to reduce the number of inputs that I've got and then I want to come back to them later, you can trigger them on, trigger them off, and it's fine. Next is the important tab, the outputs tab. Now this includes where you're going to promote, you where you're going to broadcast to. I'll go through all these settings in a second. So you've got Facebook, YouTube, LinkedIn Live, Twitch, and a custom RTMP. Now Facebook, YouTube, LinkedIn Live, and Twitch, basically self-explanatory. You'll be to then broadcast to your accounts if you have them. And the way you would do that is you just click on any one of these. So if I was to say set up LinkedIn Live, click on the little blue arrow and it will then link to LinkedIn Live. It will then ask you to log into your account and then ask if you want to stream to your personal or organization page. It will then bring you to a website, LinkedIn, and it will then ask you to link your account with your LinkedIn account. So your Switcher Studio will then talk to LinkedIn. This is just a simple couple of taps. Logging in does everything else for you. You do not need any technical detail, know-how, or anything to be able to do that. That goes for all of these sources. Custom RTMP, something a little bit different. Each streaming service will have something called RTMP, and if for example you wanted to multi-stream to multiple destinations, then you can actually set that up. So the next tab along the bottom, you've got here effects, different effects you can have between transitions. You can either have simple cuts, so for example if you wanted to cut from one scene to another one, so let's just quickly bring in an image actually, so just to show you the transition between a video for example and an image. So cut is just simply a hard cut between each one. Cross dissolve gives you a soft kind of blended merge between each one. Wipe will allow you to sweep across, much like they do in films like Star Wars. Cube, much like you would see in video editing. You can change the speed of these. So if I was to go into say cube, change that to rather than being 1 second, I want it to be quicker. Change it down to 0.5. Click back to effects and then you can see that when I click between each scene, the speed is much, much quicker. So that is effects for transitions. Next is the audio source. Now, built-in microphone is what the device is using. I'm obviously using a microphone connected to a mixer for the optimal audio for this particular video. But you can see here on the device I'm using for the demo, you've got the built-in microphone. You've also got voice mode and audio monitoring. This is used if you wanted to monitor the audio from your headphone jack to be able to hear the audio that was coming out. You can also do that too. And voice mode is the ability to optimize your voice. So if you're using your voice a lot, voice mode will optimize that very, very easily. Next tab is the auto switch feature, a very useful feature to be able to switch between your physical connected cameras. So if you had two or more devices connected, then what you can do is you can switch between them and you can change the interval of which that change happens. 3 seconds is pretty good. I tend to do that. It keeps the audiences watching. Shuffle is also quite handy too, because it then allows the cameras to be changed between each other at random moments. So it's very handy if you need a hands-free production, if you are doing music, if you are doing cooking, for example, or demonstrations and you needed both hands, then ultimately these features will be really useful for you to be able to do an auto switch feature. All you do to stop it is just simply click on one of the sources again and it will automatically stop, and then you're back in control as you would usually. Next, we have got Facebook polling. Now, this is something that you can set up if you link with your Facebook account, and then you can actually show and share the results of those polls in your video. Now, I've not set up a poll for my live stream for this demonstration, but you can do that quite easily, and it's just simple connection with Facebook and then a poll that you can then ask your audience. They will then be part of that poll and you can show the results on the screen. The really useful thing with broadcasting is the comments feature. Now, you can feature comments from Facebook as well as YouTube, but what you cannot do is you cannot do that if you are using multiple source streaming. So if you're using RTMP, you cannot see comments, but if you're streaming specifically to Facebook or YouTube, you will be able to see those comments on the screen and you will be able to feature them, which is incredible. Next window along is the video chat feature. Basically, the video chat, you can then invite a guest. You can then invite them very simply by joining a room and then inviting people to join that room. So if I was to tap on join room, and then what you can do is you can then ask to invite a video chat guest. It will then ask you to copy that link, or you can share it out on any of these or any similar apps. Copy that and then you're ready to invite them in. Video chat is really good, and I'll be doing separate videos on these for you. Next, we're getting to more feature-rich things. If you're running sports or quizzes or anything like that, you can display a scoreboard on the screen. You can design that scoreboard to look differently. So, for example, here's one that I've set up. What you can do is, as you're streaming, tap the plus on whoever gets the first score. You can change the template as well. So there's different versions of these. You've got classic, which looks a bit like this. Could be used for sports events. You've also got baseball, which is rather interesting. I think you'll quite like this. Again, quite feature rich, and you can then talk about specifics for that sport as well. Runners, balls, strikes, outs, etc. So you can really do really quite well with that one. But obviously, we're not playing baseball. We're just doing a very general demonstration here. Again, toggle on, toggle off, and you can then change the properties of the scoreboard. Again, like before, you can change the color, how it's laid out, the distance between different things, design of it. You can change the names of each team, the color of each team, and you can also change the position of it on the screen just by dragging these sliders as well. Same with the other options, and it's pretty cool. The next feature along, we've got a whole list here where you can customize and reorder each of these. So to reorder them, just tap and hold and drag. So for them at the moment, scoreboard I've kept to the bottom because I'm not exactly going to be using that, but you can drag and drop any one of these. That's no bother whatsoever. So that was a basic overview of the user interface of Switcher Studio. Have a look at my next video where we'll go in depth of how you can do some of these features in practice. Thanks for watching. See you in the next one.